Ever wondered why formulas with pi show up everywhere, even when there are no circles in sight? You can find pi in calculus, probability, and maybe even a Twitch stream. Let's explore pi in five levels, ranging from geometry to pi's surprise appearances in complex numbers, probability, and statistics. This video is brought to you by Squarespace, an all-in-one solution that makes it easy to build your website and succeed online. For level one, let's look at circles and distance. Pi is defined as the ratio of the circumference of a circle to its diameter. We might wonder if it would be better to divide by the radius instead, but in this video we'll stick with the diameter. Sorry, tau. One common situation where circles appear is when we measure distance. If we start at a point and look at all the points which are a distance 3 away along a straight line, we get this circle. This distance is called the Euclidean distance. Sometimes we need a different notion of distance, like if we're walking along streets in a square grid. Since we can only move along the streets, a distance of 3 gets us to these points that form a square instead. This is called the Manhattan distance since it resembles navigating city streets. But in many cases, we use the straight line Euclidean distance, and circles and pi will come up. For level 2, let's see why pi appears in trigonometry, the study of triangles. We start with a right triangle, and we want to understand the relationship between its sides and angles. We can scale the triangle so its hypotenuse has length 1. Then, this side opposite to the angle is called the sine of the angle, and this side adjacent to the angle is called its cosine. This works great for acute angles that we can fit in a right triangle. But can we define these trig functions for obtuse angles? The key is the circle of radius 1, that we call the unit circle. Since we scaled our right triangle to have hypotenuse 1, which equals the radius, the right triangle always has this vertex on the unit circle. The x-coordinate is the cosine of the angle, and the y-coordinate is the sine of the angle. Now we can push the angle past 90 degrees into the second quadrant and beyond, and we can still make sense of what the sine and cosine of the angle should be, the x and y coordinates of the point on the unit circle. Since we've defined our trig functions in terms of the unit circle, it helps to measure angles with that same circle. We can measure the angle by seeing how far along the circle we have to travel to create that angle. Since the radius is 1, the circumference is 2 pi, so we measure our angles from 0 to 2 pi radians. We can label each point on the unit circle by the measure of the corresponding angle, and these points are all distance 1 from the origin. We can use the same idea to label every point in the plane. First, check what angle we have to make with the positive x-axis to reach that point, and then find the distance from the origin to the point. This is called polar coordinates, which gives us a way to identify all points in the plane relative to pi and the Euclidean distance, rather than the Manhattan distance. Just like building trig functions relies on the unit circle, building a website requires the right tools. As a former software developer at a large e-commerce company, I know firsthand just how complex it can be. But with Squarespace, all that complexity is taken care of for you. Squarespace's new design intelligence combines decades of design experience with powerful new AI tools, so anyone can build a beautiful custom website, no technical skills required. Want to teach an online course? Start with a layout, upload your videos, and create engaging lessons. Add a paywall and set your price. You can get started with Squarespace payments in just a few clicks, so you can accept payments right away. Plus, your customers can pay with Klarna, Direct Debit, Apple Pay, and more. Squarespace takes care of all the technical details so you can focus on your content. Check out squarespace.com to start your free trial, and once you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/drshawn to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. For level 3, let's look at complex numbers. We often write a complex number as a plus bi, where a and b are real numbers. And we put the real part on the x-axis and the imaginary part on the y-axis. But we can also use polar coordinates to identify this number. We measure the angle theta from the positive x-axis and the distance r from the origin. If the distance r equals 1, then we know from the unit circle that the real part of this number is cosine theta and the imaginary part is sine theta. If r is not 1, then we can scale the picture by r and get the real and imaginary parts are r cosine theta and r sine theta. This gives us the polar form of complex numbers. We can take this one step farther to get perhaps the most amazing equation in all of math, Euler's formula, which connects e, pi, and I in an unexpected way. Euler's formula states that the polar form of a complex number is equal to r times e to the I theta. Then what happens when we have an angle theta equal to pi and the radius r equal to 1? We get e to the I pi equals cosine pi plus I times sine pi, which is negative 1. So e to the I pi equals negative 1. We can add 1 to each side, and now we have an equation that relates 5 of the most important numbers in math, e, I, pi, 1, and 0. We see pi is deeply connected to the imaginary number I and the base of the natural exponential function. We can actually give a quick proof of Euler's formula using a few facts from calculus. We'll need to explain what we mean by e raised to a complex number. One way to define this is to use the power series. From calculus, we know that e to the x is 1 plus x squared over 2 factorial plus x cubed over 3 factorial, and so on. We can use this as the definition of what it means to raise e to a complex number. Now, e to the ix looks like this. We can separate the terms without an I from the terms with an I to get this. To be allowed to move terms around in an infinite series, the series must be absolutely convergent, meaning even if we take the absolute value of each term, the series will still converge. This series is absolutely convergent, so we're okay to rearrange terms. These might look familiar from calculus. They're the Maclaurin series for cosine x and sine x. In other words, the Taylor series centered at 0. So now we have e to the ix equals cosine x plus I sine x. We can multiply both sides by r to get Euler's formula. For level 4, let's see how pi appears in the Gaussian integral, the integral from minus infinity to plus infinity of e to the negative x squared dx. Our goal is to find the area underneath this curve over the whole real line. This integral is essential for probability, statistics, quantum mechanics, and more. Now, it turns out there's no antiderivative for e to the negative x squared in terms of the elementary functions. These are all the functions we usually see in calculus: polynomials, rational functions, trig functions, exponentials, their inverses, their sums and products, and so on. Even though we can't find a nice antiderivative for this function, we can solve this definite integral. The idea is to start by squaring the integral, multiplying it by another copy of itself. For the second integral, we'll write the variable of integration as y. Now we can combine the integrals to get the double integral of e to the negative x squared plus y squared dx dy. The idea is now we can use polar coordinates. If we look at the graph of this surface, it's rotationally invariant, like a perfectly even spinning top. So it's naturally built around circles and polar coordinates. When we take x squared plus y squared, we get the squared distance from the origin to the point. That's r squared. Now, it might seem like we're back to where we started, just with a different variable name. But when we change variables, this has the effect of stretching or shrinking space. So we need to multiply by the Jacobian, which is like the stretching factor for how areas transform in this new coordinate system. For polar coordinates, the Jacobian is r. So we take the integral of the angle theta from 0 to 2 pi of the integral of r from 0 to infinity of e to the negative r squared times r dr d theta. That r allows us to do a u substitution. Let s equal r squared, so ds equals 2r dr. We can solve for r dr equals 1 half ds, and now this is our double integral. We can factor out the 1 half, and this inner integral is now 1. In probability, we know this because it's the integral of a probability density function over its support, the part of the domain where the function is not 0, and that will always be 1. I'll leave it to you to solve it directly with calculus if you want. Lastly, we integrate from 0 to 2 pi the constant 1 half. That's just 2 pi times 1 half, which is pi. So the square of the Gaussian integral is pi, and the original Gaussian integral equals the square root of pi. There are a few analysis details to make this fully rigorous, but this gives us a clear picture of why pi appears in this integral. For level 5, let's explore the amazing appearance of pi in the central limit theorem. Imagine we obtain some data. We could flip coins, hand out surveys, analyze soil samples, whatever scientific question we want to answer. A common goal is to understand the mean or the average of the distribution. How often on average does this particular coin come up heads? Or what properties does the soil have on average? The problem is the data come from different distributions depending on what we're investigating. And a lot of the time, we won't even know what that distribution looks like. So how can we analyze our sample if we have no reference point to work from? Well, it turns out under some mild conditions, if we take the average of a large sample and subtract its mean and divide by its standard deviation, we will always approximately have the same bell curve shape. We call this distribution the standard normal or standard Gaussian distribution, and this result is called the central limit theorem. So what are those mild conditions? There's many different versions, but perhaps the simplest is to have an independent sample, so each trial in our sample is independent of all the other trials, and the original distribution has a finite mean and variance. This last part is true, for example, anytime there's an upper bound and a lower bound on how extreme the data values can be. Making sure the distribution has a finite mean and variance lets us exclude some bizarre cases where the distribution is, on average, infinite. Pi plays a prominent role in this normal distribution. The standard normal distribution has probability density function 1 over the square root of 2 pi times e to the negative x squared over 2. Now, where did that pi come from? Well, to be a probability density function, the density function must integrate to 1. If we integrate e to the negative x squared over 2, this is almost identical to the Gaussian integral. With the change of variables, we can find that this integral is the square root of 2 pi. So dividing by the square root of 2 pi makes this a density function since its integral is 1. The central limit theorem, one of the key results in probability that underlies so much statistics and scientific research, is built from e and pi. Have you encountered pi in unexpected places? Let us know in the comments and subscribe for more videos like this one. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.